general one. But it's not just about enshrining the rights of individuals, it's also about what are the limits of the power of the state. Are you going to have the kind of constitution that prescribes what people can do and what the government can do, or what people and the government can't do? An example with this, if you think about in the kind of internet age, where internet technology and what happens on the internet moves far, far faster than legislators can. So, like, do you have a kind of blanket constitution that can control that kind of thing before? You can't do this, you can't do this. It's a very open question. What should we do? And the other thing is, should we have some kind of draft constitution before the referendum, or should we do it after? Yes, but.
Yeah, I mean, Osama, I don't know what the constitution is like in Qatar. I don't know that off the top of my head. But certainly, in just in line with what Michael was saying there, I do know that the SNP has a draft constitution that was put together some years ago. The most recent draft by Neil McCormick, now dead, unfortunately, and it looks quite a lot like the Scotland Act, which is a curiosity that it envisages a Scottish Parliament set up with limits on its power and rights of individuals protected, which more or less look like the primarily civil and political rights you find in the European Convention. I don't know what you think about that on either what kind of constitution you might want to see Scotland adopting, or whether we should begin thinking about these things now, concretely, abstractly.
To follow on from Michael's point, I mean, I suspect that while this has been floated this week, the idea of this written constitution, I don't think the SNP are going to get into a detailed discussion about what it would be until after the referendum. I think it could be very distracting for everybody to get into dreaming about that and getting into some of the anal complexities of what should and shouldn't be in it. I mean, one thing generally, I think, for whenever it does become time to draft it, is that an area of focus it needs to be about the rights of the individual. Because, I mean, there is an argument that in the UK that has got out of kilter, particularly over the last 10 years during the years of the war on terror. I mean, some of the laws have been brought in place with regards to habeas corpus, with regards to detention without trial, and so on, even going to stop and search powers and questioning powers at airports. It has gone, for many people, way beyond where it should be. And it's also noticeable within Scotland there isn't a huge amount of discussion about that. And in fact, some of it has been almost accepted, I would say, within the justice and the policing framework. And I think it would be important to have a really solid discussion about the rights of the individual versus the powers of the state with respect to crime and punishment.
And in some ways, actually, I would agree that in Scotland, many of these debates seem to pass us by. You don't, for example, hear a great degree of a kind of Scottish debate on the British Bill of Rights proposal, the controversies in England, mostly about what the European Court gets up to.
Sorry, I wanted to ask you, Andrew, about that. So, like, from what Osama said there about, with the war on terror, the laws that they introduced, I mean, what do you think about the charge that the United Kingdom government, even though it's kind of enshrined in the constitution, the European Bill of Rights, do you think that they just ignore it when they want?
Well, there's two answers to that. One of them's a very legalistic answer, and one's a political answer. On the legalistic answer, the Human Rights Act doesn't give courts the power to knock down laws passed by the UK government. So, if we're on the various litigation that you were referring to around the war on terror and the various terrorism control orders and things, that the courts just said they were incompatible with fundamental rights, and then the government changed them. Scotland's in a wee bit of a different situation because our laws can be knocked down and declared invalid if they are not compatible with the rights enshrined in the European Convention. I suppose the second question, though, is that it's certainly the case that Britain has, because of its theory of parliamentary sovereignty, not really been up for fundamental rights judicially reviewable and protected, in the same way as you get in other European countries, as you get in America, classically. And it is, I think that's a good question and a serious question, if on this kind of constitution question about what we want courts to be like in an independent Scotland. What kind of powers do we want them to have? And I think I understand what Osama was saying there about not getting into these naughty legalistic things before we've even got an independent state, and that itself looks to be challenging enough without the challenge of trying to draft a constitution. But I think there's a couple of other reasons maybe why we should put it off a bit. One is the fact that I want people who are in the Labour Party to be involved. I want people who are in the Conservative Party to be involved in framing the constitution. And they're not going to do that if this is a pre-referendum question, I think. And the second thing, actually, which is a bit more problematic, is someone was saying to me this week that she was undecided about the constitution, but would only vote yes if she could envisage a Scottish constitution that she could support being enacted. So we are in the kind of two prongs. Personally, I think the issue of trying to involve all Scots after independence and framing what kind of state we have is much more important. And I think I agree with Osama ultimately that we can't do this before we get an independent state. Michael?
Yeah, to contradict that, I mean, I agree that after it gives the opportunity to involve everyone, the advantage maybe of doing it before is that you can say, right, this is what we're campaigning for. This is the society that we want to be. And that's where it comes in with things like free education. I mean, a constitution which includes economic right, you know, a right to free education, things about the homeless that Alex Salmond also mentioned, or even economic rights guaranteeing a certain standard of living or a certain amount of money each week for the poorest and the people in most difficulty. I mean, that can be a beacon. That can be something you say, you know, this is something we want to see. This is who we want to be. And you can put that in your constitution and that can become something to campaign on. I don't know what you think of that.
Mm. I personally I tend to favor shorter rather than longer constitutions, and I prefer active democracy and continuing democracy rather than trying to settle these things in the founding documents of a nation through basic laws. I mean, it's interesting, if you look internationally, you can find some nations which started off with a kind of constitutive assembly trying to frame what their constitution would contain, and then they couldn't frame a text they could all agree on. I'm referring specifically to Israel, which has an interesting, very interesting underlying legal structure. The Knesset really began as a kind of constitutional body, but couldn't make a constitution. So now they make it on the hoof and look much more like a kind of Westminster situation. And actually that kind of politics is something that our politicians and the various loud voices in this constitutional debate are going to be much more used to than the sort of politics that you're referring to, Michael, and the sort of constitutionality maybe that you were referring to. I can see the argument, but I'm not wholly convinced that I want these things to be enshrined forever in a kind of state document.
But it brings us back to Section 30, because, you know, he called the Scottish Parliament a dictatorship, which was kind of mad. But like the original phrase in elective dictatorship came from Lord Hailsham in 1976, where he's basically saying that, you know, even with 30% of the vote, 35% of the vote, there's absolutely nothing that the United Kingdom government can't undo or do on the spur of the moment, like you said, on the hoof. And that's why I was mentioning earlier the idea about limiting the power of the state is also something that could be put into the constitution.
Mm. Yeah, I think it's really important that we talk about and think about these constitutional ideas. I think I've said that before when we first met. It's important for us to work up a constitutional imagination. I think the problem with it is that when we get into specifics, when we get into the sort of substance about what power should the government have, what should be the relationship between the executive, the legislature and the courts. If we have these positive rights and social rights enshrined in the constitution, should they be judicially enforceable? Those kind of questions. And I can see everyone's eyes, I can feel them glazing over here, but that is where the justice and the real substance of constitutionality kicks in for me. And or maybe it doesn't have to. I mean, I suppose you could keep these things as loose principles and you can't take them to courts, and then we might be able to agree on abstract things about more liberty and free education than if it was judicially really enforceable. But I think it's going to be a difficult conversation, a messy one. All you have to do is read the accounts of how the United States Constitution was framed, and that's a document which only runs to just over 4,000 words. I imagine the Scottish Constitution, there'll be pressures on it to become much longer and maybe include hundreds of sections.
Just to finish that up, because legal debates can get long.
Destroying an arid is the phrase that you're looking for.
Yeah, did you know that in Samoa it's actually against the law for a man to forget his wife's birthday? We could include that.
You see, this is how constitution bloat happens. Everyone wants their own domestic turmoil to become enshrined in the nation's founding documents. There's a good example. It's a good example of where we can get to.
What kind of country do we want to be?
I think we could agree one where people remember their wives' birthdays would not be a bad start.
Yeah, it should be the other way around as well, I think.
Yeah, well, equality has to be enshrined as well.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
All right. On that, from the a very wide and theoretical angle to a rather more local and focused one, there's obviously been controversies in Osama. I think it's your home city, and it's certainly where my parents live, Glasgow, this week. We're certainly not going to talk about all of them, because some people have private griefs of their own private griefs. But Michael, you were taking a look at, you're from a West End guy as well, so we're all a bit Glaswegian. The various sort of calumnies and disasters going on in Glasgow Council this week. Which one was your favourite?
Well, the one about what happens in cars is of no interest to me. But what happens with payoffs that have been described as, what was the word? I don't want to get this wrong. Misconduct, where someone who's in the regeneration organization for some of the poorer parts of the city's getting a discretionary pension augmentation of £230,000, as well as another kind of £240,000 through the contract. I think that's a far more important story than what's going on anywhere else.
Nice work if you can get it. Sam, I mean, you're obviously far off from Glasgow now, but it must still make your heart sink, these kind of stories about sort of Glasgow's civic life and its mischiefs. And
there's a lot of murkiness there, and you know, if you speak to anyone in the third sector within Glasgow, especially, I mean, there's all sorts of shenanigans going on, most of which has never seen the light of day, but which might someday. And you know, people need to be careful how they're conducting themselves. But I mean, I think what we actually hear of, by my reckoning, is the tip of the iceberg. I mean, I'll say a little thing about cars, and not in any way to get into the detail of it, but just to note this. I mean, I actually have not read anything in depth. I don't know what happened, but I did see that Graham Henry, the SNP group leader within the council, he refused to comment on the story. And I think that's to be commended. But I would just note that I think if it had been the other way around, that wouldn't have been the case. I think the Section 30 debate in Westminster shows some of that kind of negative black heart politics over nothing. But I think if this had been an SNP politician in a car, you wouldn't have got that level of dignity about the response.
Yeah, I mean, I must say, I'm like Michael. I mean, I wrote something silly about the whole Gordon Matheson thing, but I think, it's people do daft things, and I think you may be right there, Osama, about the reception of that those occasional daft things that people do receive is, it might be a bit different if things were reversed. We know, obviously, another kind of debate going on is around Glasgow George Square and the various kind of marches and counter marches in terms of redesigning it into something, some extraordinary space. And I don't know, it sort of seems kind of worrying about how many people get consulted, about how open Glasgow civic life is. I mean, I was thinking about, people were talking about Borgen. I don't know if either of you watch Borgen habitually, but a good site, I think, to do a Scottish political drama would be Glasgow City Chambers. You could make it quite dramatic, I think, though perhaps a bit less attractive.
I think your production process would be bogged down in an illegal storm before you even got started.
Yeah, I think people would also say that's just too fantastical to be true as well. I mean, cross between The Wire and I don't know, Borgen and The West Wing and everything thrown in there, it would just be an amazing series.
I think so. Maybe I'll pitch it to someone eventually when I get my writing.
I've not seen Borgen. That's twice you've mentioned it. I'm more of a Breaking Bad person.
I think it's really interesting. I mean, I am joining the kind of, I think there's several people who are attentive to Scottish politics who are rather obsessed with it. And it's just a really good show, and it's a bit serious. You can't imagine the Scottish version. We need more jokes and sarcasm, I think, than you get in this rather full-faced Danish production. But it's just really interesting that a small country of 5 million folk, pretty much like Scotland, is able to produce a piece of drama of self-representation, which, according to my Danish friends, is recognisable as an echo of the, what their actual politics are, and it's diverting, and it's well-written, and the production values are good, and think, and what do we get? We have River City.
Well, can I make a heartfelt plea to Scottish programme makers? Enough with...